Chapter 5. Home Again. The horse-drawn bus rattled over the cobbles and came to a standstill in Market Square, Barnsley. The passengers emerged one by one, and eventually Hudson appeared, somewhat tired and travel-stained after the long journey from London. How friendly and familiar everything appeared. How good it was to be welcomed back home by his strict yet genial father, and by the gentle mother with her smoothly brushed hair and dainty muslin cap tied under the chin. How pleasant, as he walked out, stick in hand, for a stroll, to be greeted warmly by this friend and another, glad to see him and eager to hear of his life in the faraway capital. It was all so different from London. There he was just an unimportant stranger, and walked along the busy streets with never a greeting from anyone to cheer him. Weak as he still was from his illness, home was the place above all that afforded him complete rest and satisfaction. He sat contentedly by the fire in the warm parlor behind the shop, glad of the old familiar setting that brought back so many happy memories. What scenes were revived by the sight of the large, sturdy table in the middle of the room, for instance. Once more, he was a very small boy, dressed in his best velvet suit, sitting at the table surrounded by visitors. He was watching his mother cutting a delicious-looking apple pie into generous portions, which were handed along to everyone but her own small son, who sat politely silent, as he had been trained, waiting in vain for the plate intended for him. Came the realization that somehow Mother had overlooked him this time. He had been told that on no account must he ask for anything at the table. The story of his ingenuity had passed down into the annals of family history as it was recalled time and time again how, during a lull in the conversation, a little voice had inquired, "Mama, do you think apple pie is good for little boys?" It was at that table, too, that he had sat, day after day, learning the lessons his father set for him, until eventually, at the age of 11, he went to school. Though he had been much happier under his father's tuition than at school, he became one of the star pupils. There was something eminently wholesome and manly about this father of his, with his rigid ideas of right and wrong and his unyielding discipline. Hudson had learned to be punctual long before he had his life ruled by school bells. Woe betide the one who was not ready to sit at table, hands washed and hair brushed, when it was time for a meal. If there are 5 people and they are all kept waiting 1 minute, then 5 minutes are lost, Father would say sternly, adding slowly, "Minutes that can never be found again." Learn to dress quickly was another of his axioms. A very good reason he had for it, too, for you have to do it once at least every day of your life. So obviously one might as well get used to it. If Hudson smiled at these memories as he sat in the cozy home, it was with the affectionate amusement with which children review the idiosyncrasies of parents. It was interesting to remember that it was from his father he had first learned of China, when, at 5 years, he had heard him exclaim vehemently, "Why don't we send missionaries there? That is the country to aim at, with its teeming population, strong, intelligent, scholarly people." Now, nearly 15 years after, Hudson himself was preparing to go there. As he spent those weeks at home with plenty of time to think, he marveled at the way his destiny had been revealed to him. Surely this was his destiny, the particular work that was appointed for him to do, "Go for me to China." He could never forget the night when he received that divine commission. Only one other experience, perhaps, stood out more vividly in his memory. China had not come into it that afternoon in the old warehouse, when his whole outlook on life had been completely changed, but, had it not been for what took place then, certainly he would have no thought of going to China now. Many a time Hudson lived through that momentous afternoon. It was over 3 years ago, yet as clear in his mind as if it had happened yesterday. He was 16 years of age and already disappointed with life. How dull it seemed, living at home and helping his father in the shop. It was not that he did not love his parents, for he did, but he found their manner of life irksome. Balls and hunting parties found no place in their lives. They preferred singing hymns in the little chapel down the road, and Hudson, dutifully accompanying them, thought it very dull. He tried his best to enjoy it all as they did, but he could not. His own private desire was to live in a large house with a number of servants, from which he could sally forth, clad in a scarlet jacket, to go hunting. He longed to possess that which would enable him to rush along at the greatest possible speed. A horse, of course. Motorcycles were not yet invented. These desires, however, could evidently not be satisfied, and it was in a discontented frame of mind that he wandered into the parlor one afternoon in June, looking for something to do. He glanced through the bookcase but saw nothing there that appealed to him, so turned his attention to a basket of small paper-covered books and picked out one of them. "I know what this will be," he thought. He knew the sort of paper-covered booklets his father was fond of collecting. "It will have an interesting story to begin with, and a moral or a sermon at the end." Well, he decided he would read the interesting story and leave the rest. So he took it off to the warehouse, where he would be undisturbed by younger sisters with ideas for games. He sat down among the boxes and bottles to read it. He little knew that at that very moment his mother, on holiday about 70 miles away, was kneeling beside her bed, praying for him with unusual earnestness and intensity. Nor had he any idea that 6 weeks previously, his sister Amelia, 13 years old, had determined that she would pray for him 3 times a day until his mind was changed about God. That was what he needed, a change of mind about God. He had told her that he was not really at all sure about God, and very moody he seemed as a result. He was not even sure there was a God. Not sure there was a God? Amelia, being herself quite sure about God, felt this state of affairs must not be allowed to continue. Realizing, however, that her arguments, convincing and conclusive as they appeared to her, did not seem so to him, she came to the conclusion that only God could change Hudson's mind. That is why she determined to pray 3 times every day until it happened. She even made a note of her decision in her diary. For all her corkscrew curls and frilly frocks, Amelia was a young person of some determination, and pray 3 times a day she did. Unaware of all this, Hudson sat in the warehouse and read the booklet. It was the reading of that little booklet that completely changed his outlook on life. Quite suddenly and unexpectedly, it dawned upon him that what he had heard about God and Jesus Christ from his earliest childhood was true. God was real. Jesus Christ was his son and had died for the sake of sinners. He had come to life again and was in heaven, alive, able to see everything on earth, able to see him right there in the warehouse. He had died for the sins of the whole world. Therefore, he had died for the sins of Hudson Taylor. He had promised eternal life to all who believed on him. Therefore, he had promised eternal life to Hudson Taylor. He heard prayer. Therefore, he would hear Hudson Taylor's. What a remarkable thing that, having heard it so many times before, it had only just dawned on him. Somehow, it made Hudson feel as he felt when he suddenly saw the simple solution to a mathematical problem that had puzzled him for hours. Relieved, enlightened, exuberant, everything was different now. The heavy feeling of discontent, the uneasy sensation of having done something wrong that would one day be found out, were gone. He felt free. It seemed too good to last. But it did last. 3.5 years later, sitting contentedly by the glowing, crackling fire, Hudson knew that it had lasted. The years since that June afternoon had not been idle, easy ones. Indeed, they had contained certain trials and hardships hitherto unknown. But there had always been the exhilarating consciousness of adventure in an unseen realm, the stimulation of finding out that God answered his prayers, that God would lead him into unexplored pathways he would never have discovered himself, was far greater than that of galloping along after the hounds. And he knew the simple secret of getting rid of that sensation of guilt. He merely did what he knew to be right. And when he inadvertently did that which was wrong, he confessed it to God, who has promised to forgive when sin is acknowledged. Yes, it lasted. The weeks at Barnsley sped past all too quickly, and a renewed Hudson faced London again. Not without many a pang did he bid farewell to the intimate warmth and love of home. He was beginning to know, from personal experience, what it meant to tread a lonely pathway and to endure weakness and privation without the sustaining comfort of like-minded companions. After all, that was the way to grow strong and self-reliant. Pioneer missionary work required men, not mollycoddled weaklings. Hudson, delicate from childhood, was determined to be a pioneer missionary, and therefore he must be, in every sense of the word, a man. His parents, however, not unnaturally, were distinctly averse to his becoming a man if doing so involved returning to a diet of apples and brown bread washed down by water. Indeed, they had grave doubts as to whether he would ever become one that way. Even Hudson himself agreed the matter was open to question. Instead of residing in the Soho boarding house and buying his own food, it was decided he should obtain a position as doctor's assistant where he could live with the family. He did. He attended lectures at the hospital in the morning, assisted his surgeon employer from dinner time until 9 o'clock in the evening, and the remainder of the day was his own. He could start studying for lectures then. It was a strenuous life, certainly, but he was happy. Good food and a comfortable home did make a difference to his spirits, he found. And during the next 6 months, he gained not only much useful medical knowledge and experience of human nature, but further evidence of that which he knew to be of even greater importance, the help God would give in all matters about which he prayed. One outstanding example was the case of a man with gangrene. A thoroughly hardened drunkard he was, and now he lay dying, though he did not know it. "It's no use speaking to him about religion," Hudson was warned when he visited the home where the man lodged. "He's an atheist. He won't hear a thing about religion." We asked a scripture reader to come and visit him once, and he got in a towering rage and ordered him out of the room. The vicar of the parish had called too. Alas, he was forced to depart in some confusion, for the infuriated invalid only permitted him to advance near enough to spit in his face. Hudson felt not unlike a gladiator entering the arena when he called for the first time to dress the man's foot. Speak to him about God's willingness to forgive his sins and to receive him as the father received the prodigal, he must. Why, the man was dying. What hope was there for him in this world or the next without God? But Hudson decided to wait a propitious occasion to broach the important subject. Until the angry and rebellious attitude had in some measure altered, it would be worse than useless to do so. He took special care in dressing the man's foot and said nothing about religion for several days. But the man was on his mind. He felt responsible for him. And many times a day, Hudson prayed for him. Learn to move men through God by prayer. If his prayers for the softening of hard hearts did not prove effective here in England, he could scarcely expect to be successful in China. Gradually, the man's attitude changed. It changed, first of all, toward Hudson. The young medical student dressed his foot so carefully and skillfully that the pain was considerably eased, and he felt really grateful. Indeed, he went so far as to say so. This surely was the opportunity for which he had waited, thought Hudson. He explained to the man how he trusted in God to help him in all his medical work and then went on to the subject of everyone's need of God's forgiveness and mercy. Had he been the scripture reader or the vicar, he would probably have fared as they did. However, as he was the doctor, able to relieve pain, the man managed to swallow his wrath, merely expressing it by turning his back without a word and remaining there with his face against the wall until Hudson departed. It was not exactly encouraging, but at any rate, it was a step in the right direction. The next day, Hudson broached the subject again with the same result. And after several more visits, his heart began to sink. Was it any use continuing? It seemed not. One day he felt so discouraged, so anxious about the man who, despite his ill temper, was so often in his thoughts that he felt something rising in his throat and tears came to his eyes. "Oh, friend, you must listen," he exclaimed and walked toward the bed. "Oh, if only you would let me pray with you." And he found himself speaking in a broken voice, expecting the man to turn his back as usual. But the man did not. He looked with surprise at the overwrought doctor, who was obviously so upset about something, and said, "Well, if it will relieve you to do it, you can." It was scarcely a warm invitation, but Hudson needed nothing more. He knelt down, closed his eyes, and prayed aloud. "Oh, that God would open the eyes of the dear man. Oh, that he might know God was real, that Jesus Christ had died to save him from the punishment due for his sins, that forgiveness was his for the asking." The man lay silent, and although he made no comment then, it was evidently the real turning point in his life. No longer did he turn his back when Hudson spoke to him about God. The realization was dawning on him that what this earnest young man repeatedly told him was true. And if it were true, why not believe it? Why not? And so it came about that one day Hudson left his patient's room almost walking on air. The bitter, hardened old man, who had not been inside a church for 40 years and then only to get married, was lying in bed, his eyes reverently closed, learning to pray to his God. End of chapter 5. Chapter 6. Storm at Sea. The ship was moving. The gangway had been removed after the friendly mate, the last man to leave the shore, had jumped aboard, and now, slowly and silently, the ship was leaving the dock. Hudson stood alone on deck, waving to the little group of people standing watching him depart. His eyes were fixed upon his mother. Dear, gentle, stalwart little mother. She had tried so hard to be brave. But down in his cabin, when she had been gently smoothing the bedclothes on his bunk, he had caught her with tears on her cheeks. Just now, after she had said the last goodbye and left the ship, she had sat down quickly on an old piece of timber, as though she were going to faint. Hudson had run down the gangway to her and given her a last reassuring hug. "Don't cry, Mother dear," he had said. "It is only for a little while. We shall meet again." But he had to hurry back on board and leave her. She was standing up now, her full skirts billowing in the breeze, waving her handkerchief to him. Hudson, loath to lose sight of her, suddenly turned and climbed up into the rigging to get a better view. Standing there among the swaying ropes, he held on firmly with one hand and with the other waved his hat vigorously. It would cheer her, perhaps, to see him like that. High above his head, the sails were flapping and the mast creaking as the ship drew toward the dock gates. The beloved figure on shore seemed to be getting smaller and smaller, and her little fluttering handkerchief more minute. "Oh!" Hudson stopped waving at the sound of that piercing cry. It was his mother. The ship was passing through the dock gates now and making for the open sea, bearing her only son away to that distant, unknown land, China. This was goodbye indeed. The anguish of that cry went through Hudson's heart like a knife. What this was costing her, she was suffering so much more than he. A lump rose in his throat. The ship was gathering speed now, and he could no longer distinguish the little figures standing at the end of the dock. He strained his eyes, peering through the misty air, until he knew he could see them no more, and slowly swung down onto the deck, the sound of that cry still ringing in his ears. A new thought was submerging his mind. If it cost his mother so much to see him leave her for China, what must it have cost God to part with his son when Jesus came to earth to die for man's sin? Was not God a father? Was not Jesus his only begotten son? Somehow the sacrifice of parting that he and his mother were feeling so keenly seemed to bring him nearer to God, to understand better what was meant by the love of God. God loved, so he knew what this sort of suffering was, too. Hudson felt strangely strengthened in the midst of his pain as he went down to his cabin. He was the only passenger on the Dumfries, a small sailing ship of only 470 tons, and he had been told it would be 5 or 6 months before it would dock in Shanghai. In 1853, there was no Suez Canal route to the Far East, and the little ship must breast its way through the waves around the Cape of Good Hope and brave the typhoons of the Pacific before it could reach its destination. A long sea voyage indeed, and one that provided him with enough danger and excitement during the first 10 days to last him the rest of the trip. Almost as soon as the Dumfries entered the Irish Channel, she had to make her way in the teeth of a gale, and for days she was driven hither and thither like a cork by the force of the winds. Hudson had never known anything like it, and rapidly revised any ideas he may have had about the romance of a sailor's life. The timbers creaked and groaned. Seawater found its way into the cabins. His clothes felt damp and sticky, and as the days and nights passed, the storm seemed to increase in fury until on Sunday afternoon the seas were mountainous. Hudson struggled up on deck and, clinging to the side of the ship, looked around on the wild scene. The sea was white with foam, and waves came rolling one after another until it seemed to tower over the little Dumfries like threatening cliffs as it floundered in a trough of swirling water. When it seemed that it must be submerged, then the vessel would begin to tilt dangerously, and Hudson, feet sliding on the slippery deck, could scarcely keep his balance until the ship perched dizzily on top of the liquid cliff only to plunge down again as the wave rushed on. As he looked across the raging seas, he saw a large ship astern, beaten along by the winds, and a little brig. How helpless they all were, and how powerless they would be if the waves dashed them together. The captain was standing beside him, face set and anxious. Never had he seen a wilder sea, he admitted. Unless God helps us, he added solemnly, there is no hope. How far are we from the Welsh coast? Asked Hudson. The dangerous Welsh coast with its rocks jutting out into the sea. 15 or 16 miles. But they were drifting toward it, for the west wind was blowing. We must carry more sail. The more sail we carry, the less we shall drift. God grant the mast can stand it. What if they were to snap under the strain of the wind? But the risk had to be taken. Their lives were at stake. He ordered 2 sails to be hoisted. The ship plunged forward faster than ever, with the wind filling the sails. It was rolling one-sidedly, with the waves at times rushing right over the lee bulwarks. The evening was drawing on, and the sun was sinking behind a bank of clouds. Hudson watched it solemnly. Tomorrow thou wilt rise as usual, he thought, feeling rather dramatic. But unless a miracle happens, All that will be left of us will be a few broken timbers floating on the waves. How his family would sorrow if he were drowned. And what a waste of money for the Chinese Evangelization Society, who had spent money on his outfit and passage. And what would it feel like, that struggle in the raging waters before they finally closed over his head? It was a melancholy thought. Hudson felt cold and lonely and rather frightened in the gathering darkness, with the wind roaring and the spray beating his face. He fumbled his way slowly to the gangway and descended into his cabin. Finding his hymn book and Bible, he sat in his bunk and started to read. "Let not your heart be troubled. Ye believe in God, believe also in me." There was such a calmness about the familiar words that somehow he began to feel calmer himself. He read on, and after a while, his eyes tired with reading in the uncertain light of the swaying lantern, he threw himself on the bunk and fell asleep. When he awoke, it was approaching midnight. The ship was still pitching violently and the wind roaring. How far were they now from land in those treacherous rocks? Hudson went up on deck again. Peering across the moonlit waters, he saw a light ahead. It was the Holyhead Lighthouse sending forth its warning to all ships that might be approaching too near. The Holyhead Lighthouse. And the rocks. "Can we clear it?" he shouted to the captain, the sound of his voice almost carried away by the wind. "If we make no leeway, we may just do it," the captain shouted back. "But if we drift, God help us." And they did drift. Helplessly, they watched the light to which they were drawing nearer and nearer. How long would it take the ship to reach it, drifting at this rate? "Have we got 2 more hours?" shouted Hudson. "Probably not so long," was the reply. "Less than 2 hours." Hudson went down to his cabin again, tears starting to his eyes as he thought of his father, his mother, his sisters. Never to see them again on this earth. How they would grieve, not knowing what had happened to him when the ship went down. He took out his pocketbook and carefully wrote in his name and address. If his body was found, they would identify him, he thought. That provision having been made, he looked around for means to save himself from drowning at all. He had not given up all hope of survival. Seeing a hamper which he thought might float, he decided to take it up on deck and hold on to it tight when the ship went down. He put a few things in it which he thought might be useful if he ever got to land, and struggled up on deck again. All the time, in his heart, he was praying. He found it almost impossible to frame coherent sentences, for his mind was in a turmoil. Something within went on mutely beseeching God, his Father, to save them. He looked at the sea and saw the waters white with foam in the bright moonlight. Only a few hundred yards ahead of them, it seemed, was land and the rocks. "Can the boats live in a sea like this?" he asked the captain, wondering why they were not lowered.
"No!
Couldn't we lash some spars together and make a raft of it?" suggested Hudson.
"No time!"
The captain moved suddenly as though he had made up his mind.
"We must try and turn her, or it's all up!"
he shouted. They seemed to be making straight for the land that lay just ahead.
"We'll have to tack. The sea may sweep the deck in turning and wash everything overboard, but we must try."
And he gave the order. The effort to turn the ship outward failed. The force of the wind and the waves was too strong. Desperately, the captain turned the ship the other way. It meant sailing dangerously near the rocks. But with the added impetus of the wind in the sails, it was just possible they might be cleared. All eyes were on those rocks, with the white foam dashing against them and splashing feet high into the air. Could the ship steer clear? They were only 2 ships' length away, and if the little vessel could not hold her course, she would be dashed to pieces within a few minutes. Breathlessly, Hudson watched, clinging to the rigging as the ship, tossed up and down, beat her way through the waves. They were passing the rocks. They were passing. They had passed. Now could they but beat out to sea, away from that dangerous coast? They might yet be saved. Then it happened. The wind that had been beating so relentlessly on them veered in their favor. The change of direction was only slight, to be sure, a mere 2 points, but it was sufficient to carry them away from the coast. As the sun rose on Monday morning, it shone down, not as Hudson had feared, on a few broken timbers, but on a little vessel, sails gallantly hoisted, making for the open sea. End of chapter 6. Amazing grace, how sweet.